Welcome to the Cambridge Financial Podcast with Bert Salazar, CEO at Cambridge Financial Partners, LLC. This podcast is all about tax-preferred retirement planning, economics, financial risk management, and achieving a risk-free and successful financial life. Now, your host, Bert Salazar. Bert Salazar.
Hey, good day, everyone. Welcome to another podcast of the Bert Salazar Show. So, as always, I'm excited to be here with you, as I am every single week. This is episode 165, and this one I call Clean Up on Aisle 7. You guys have probably heard that sound 1,000 times when you go grocery shopping and someone spills something on an aisle, then all of a sudden you hear attention, clean up on aisle 7. So when we apply that to a financial cleanup or to an economic cleanup, that means that there are a lot of things that are going on in this country today and that are going on throughout the economy that are going to require some immediate cleanup, especially on aisle 7. So I want to kind of touch bases with all of you today on some of those items. And the reason why I wanted to do this today was very simple. You know, I do my reviews with clients on a quarterly basis. And I have a number of clients that I review, or I started to review now in the fourth quarter of 2021. And last year I had 5 reviews. I normally try to have anywhere between 3 and 6 reviews on a weekly basis, so that way I can pace myself and do, you know, the best possible job I can with my clients in engaging where they're at in relation to their goals and objectives and so forth. So I try to limit the number of clients that I review on a weekly basis for those reasons, and also based on the complexity of each client. Some clients I review 2-3 times a year. Other clients, we only need to do a review once a year, depending on the complexity of their economic plans. So I had 5 reviews last week, and it was very interesting because I picked these clients on purpose, because these clients had already told me that they were going to be retiring in 2022. Two of them, I believe, if I'm not mistaken, are retiring in January. Another one is retiring in February, and then one in March. And I believe the other one is going to be sometime in May, although he has not decided what day he was going to pull the retirement trigger. But at the end of the day, they're going to be retiring very early in 2022. Most of them are going to be leaving the workforce in the first quarter of 2022. So as I start to have these conversations with the clients, I started to jot down some of the notes, because I know I wanted to do a podcast about this. And pretty much now, each client was different and the conversations were different, but many of the topics were the same, because all of these clients, although they don't know each other personally, they all kind of seem to have some of the same issues that we'll talk about in the next few minutes. Obviously, all these clients were concerned about taxes because of the fact that now they're going to be retiring. So they're going to have a segmented retirement plan, which many times, you know, I created for them. And for some of those 5 clients actually have been with me on the average for about 8 years. But some of the clients, you know, they come in late in the game, so they have already done, you know, some of their planning somewhere else. But these clients were very concerned about taxes. And the fact that there's a great talk now, especially under the Biden administration, where taxes are going to go up higher, and to what level they're going to go up. What I can tell you regarding taxes is that taxes are going to go up for everybody. And this is something that I share with these clients. Although they said, well, you know, Bert, we hear that it's going to be more so for those people that are making in excess of $400,000. I said, well, that may be what they're trying to tell you, but that's not what's going to happen in reality, because what happens to these politicians, and many of them know it, they just want to play the game, because remember, they're puppeteers, and we, the American people, we are the puppets. But what happens is that the vast majority of these Americans that are earning north of $400,000, guess who they are? Well, they happen to be, you know, small business owners. So you may have a mom and pop's store and you're making north of $400,000. Obviously, you're going to fall into the tax trap, which is going to be very critical. Now, as a small business owner, what do you think you're going to do? Well, there are only three things as a small business owner or even as a large corporation that you can do in order to offset the increase in taxes at the corporate level. Well, number one, the thing that you could do is you can reduce the dividends that you're going to pay your shareholders if you have any. Well, how long do you think those shareholders are going to be with you? Because if you start to reduce their dividend, you know, what do you think they're going to do with their money? Well, they're going to take it from you and they're going to give it to somebody else who's going to pay them more. And then they're going to get a higher rate of return on their dividends along those lines. So as a business owner, it's going to be very challenging for you to try to convince your shareholders that reducing their dividend is going to be a good thing, especially when it comes to paying taxes. Now, what else can you do as a business owner? Well, if you're not going to reduce dividends on the shareholders, you know, the other thing that you could do is you can reduce your employee benefits. But that's not going to go well either, because if you start to reducing your employee benefits, you know, your employees are not going to be very happy with you. Number one, they're not going to give you their optimum output as far as giving you the most for your money when it comes to the work that they do for you, because you're already reducing their benefits. So that's going to be one issue. The other issue is that these employees are not fools, and they understand that in today's society where, you know, there are so many people that are, so many companies that are looking for employees and very few employees to fill the jobs with, obviously it's a supply and demand issue. So they're going to go to the next employer who's going to pay them more. So now you're going to have a challenge in your hands, because now it's going to be more difficult for you to sell your products and services if your employees are not happy with you and or if they're leaving you as an employer. So that's not going to happen either. So you're not going to be cutting the dividends on your shareholders. You're not going to be reducing your employee benefits. So the last thing, and this is the one that most small business owners will do and most corporations will do, and that's without saying that all of them will do it, because I feel very strongly that all of them are going to be doing this, they're going to be passing that additional cost to the consumer. And that's something that is happening. I did a video a week ago about this issue as well. And I was in Portland in October for my daughter's wedding. And we went to several restaurants while we were there and so forth. And all the restaurants in their menu, you know, have a note that says that they have had to increase the pricing some by charging you an additional fee per table, and others by just increasing the pricing on the food that you consume at the restaurants because of a small business tax in Portland, because of the homeless tax in Portland, and also the $15 mandatory minimum wage. So what are these restaurants doing? Well, they're putting that on their menu, and they're passing that tax liability to the consumer. So what I was telling these clients is no matter what, they're all going to be paying for this increase in taxes, whether they want to or not. Now, that brought us to the second point that they were very concerned with, which is the issue with inflation. Now, you hear that the latest report that just came out a couple of weeks ago, inflation in the United States is now at 6.2%. That's pretty scary, because we haven't been at that level in many decades. What I did say to these clients is, well, number one, their investments are not producing 6.2%. So that's an issue that they need to worry about. Number two, they also need to understand that inflation is not tax deductible. And that's a big issue, because people say, well, is my true inflation rate 6.2%? The answer is no. Because let's say, since inflation is not tax deductible, in order for you to have an investment that will net out 6.2%, you need to have already paid the taxes on on that investment return. So if you happen to be, let's say, in the 20% tax bracket, so you're going to take that 6.2%. Let me do the math real quick. Times 0.20 in the 20% tax bracket. So that will bring your total return on your investment has to be at least 7.44%. So after you pay that 20% in taxes, you have a 6.2% net. What if you happen to be in the 30% tax bracket? So again, times 0.30, so that would be, and let's add the 6.2%, so that means you need to be earning just north of 8%, 8.06%, in order to pay the tax and then have a 6.2% net rate of return in order to offset the cost of inflation. But also bear in mind the following. That's just the average inflation rate. When you take a look at the essential items that we as Americans consume every day, which is food, energy, gas, you know, and things that are so essential for us every single day, the inflation increases are much, much higher than that 6.2%. Just go to a grocery store and see what you can get today for $100. It's going to be minimum. Just go try to gas up at the gas station. Try to gas up your car. It's more than likely going to cost you either 40 to 50% more just to gas up your price. So when you take a look at inflation, you got to take a look, not only look at what the average inflation rate is, but also look at the essential items that you need to purchase every day in order to maintain your standard of living, and then talk to me about what the real inflation is. Now, can you do something about that? Sure, you can also try to manage your personal inflation rate. So if gas prices are high, well, try not to drive too much, you know, or stay closer to home. But, you know, how many of you are willing to do that? So you're going to have to, no matter what, if you want to offset that inflation rate, you're going to have to pay the price, and you have to curtail and reduce your standard of living in order to offset. Now, you may be able to do that for a little while, just like, you know, going on a diet. How many people actually go on a diet over the long term? Well, most of them don't. That's why we have, you know, a very fat American society in the United States. So you may be able to do the inflation game for a little bit of time, but that's about it. Stock market volatility, we're actually starting to see it now, because although the market, even with all the bad news that we have had, continues to go up, now they're starting to take a look at it, and now you see the market now with a lot more volatility, because Wall Street is understanding that this is not something that, you know, is good for the economy. When you withhold more money in taxes from people, people have less money to invest. When you increase inflation, people are concerned, they're fear. So that's going to create stock market volatility, and the same thing with the interest rate volatility. You know, try to take $100,000 now to a bank and try to get a CD and see what they're going to pay you. They're going to pay you 0.00% for your $100,000 in that CD. And then last but not least, another big issue that these clients had was the impact of politics on personal and economic growth. And that's a scary one, because at the end of the day, nobody truly knows what's going to happen. Now, there's going to be obviously election, the midterm elections are going to be in 2022. And that's very concerning. But the way that the Democrats are running the country today is not something that, you know, should be pleasing to anyone, whether you happen to be a Republican or a Democrat. Because at the end of the day, remember, guys, you know, we're all puppets, and these are the puppeteers that we actually elect to Congress to run our lives. And most of them are multimillionaires, or at least by the time they leave Congress, they're multimillionaires while everybody else is poor. So you got to be worried about what's happening. And now the Democrats control, you know, the House, the Senate, and the presidency, and take a look at what's going on and the expenditures. And by the way, the more money you spend, you know, the definition of inflation is what? Too much money chasing too few goods. So the more money you print and the more money, the more debt this country gets into, guess what? Every single dollar that you have in your retirement account is worth less and less and less every single day. One area that I want to talk a little bit about today, which is also part of the same conversation I had with clients, is something I call the path to economic slavery. And let me see if I can put this in a way that makes it more feasible for all of us and all of you to kind of understand. If you work for an employer or if you go to work every day and you happen to find yourself at 100% taxation, meaning that if you make $100 a day, you pay $100 in taxes every day, you're basically a slave. Now, you may not have somebody beating you over the head every day for you to get up and go to work like during slavery, but you are a slave because you're working for nothing. You're working for the man, you're working for a company that is slaving you all the way to the grave, because for every dollar that you make, they're going to charge you $1 in taxes, or the government is going to charge you 100% taxation. So once again, at 100% taxation, you are a slave. Now, on the other side of that spectrum, at 0% taxation, you're pretty much, you're basically a free man. Now, there are very few things in life that are black and white. There are many shades of gray along those lines. But one thing you need to be aware of is that as you move the tax dial to the right, every move will get you closer and closer to slavery. Let me repeat that again. As you move the tax dial to the right from zero, every move will get you closer to slavery. And that's something very important to note because, you know, one of the main things that you hear the political pundits all the time is, you know, we got to make certain that everybody pays their fair share. We want to make certain, and this is a big one, that the wealthy, they need to pay their fair share because they're not paying enough, according to these political pundits. Well, let me kind of clear that, and let me give you that clean up on aisle 7, which is the title for this podcast. Actually, I agree that the wealthy need to pay their fair share, and I don't agree that they'd have to pay more. I would agree that they should be paying less. And why do I say that? And you may say, Bert, you're crazy. How can you say that the wealthy need to pay less? Well, let's look at the numbers. The top 1% of earners in the United States pay 40% of all taxes. The top 10% of Americans earning money today pay 70% of all taxes in the U.S. So when you're asking me, Bert, you know, what should they be paying or what should the wealthy be paying? Well, listen, if I'm paying 70 cents out of every dollar or 40 cents out of every dollar, I think I've paid enough and I'm not wealthy by the definition of wealth. But when someone says that the wealthy need to pay their fair share, nobody knows what that fair share is because the top 1% is paying 40% of all the taxes and the top 10% are paying 70% of all taxes. Now, what's interesting about this is that the bottom 50% of Americans pay no taxes at all. So there's a major disparity there, and this is based on the tax code because it is a progressional tax code. The more money you earn, the more taxes you're going to pay along the way, which is something that is very, very critical for all of us to understand. Now, the challenge with trying to get the wealthy to pay more, again, take a look at the small business owners. They're not going to be paying that tax. The tax is going to be passed on to the consumer, you and I and all of us that are listening to this podcast today. So if you start raising those tax liabilities on the wealthy, what do you think, or on the major corporations, what do you think they're going to do? They're going to be passing that all along to us. The other thing is that most Americans don't understand that the wealthy in this country and the large corporations, they employ millions and millions and millions of Americans every single year. And there are so many other taxes other than federal income taxes that these wealthy individuals and these corporations pay that none of us pay attention, because the political puppeteers don't want us to pay attention to that. They don't want us to be educated. They want us to be uneducated, because the more uneducated you are, the easier it is for them to control your each and every move every single day of the week. So for instance, if you're an employer, you're going to pay Social Security taxes on behalf of your employees. You're going to pay Medicare taxes on behalf of your employees. If you generate capital gains, you're going to pay capital gains taxes. You're going to pay unemployment taxes. You're going to pay surcharges for the different taxes and so forth. So when you truly factor in all the taxes that the wealthy pay or that corporations pay in the United States, is enormous compared to many other parts of the world. And we find ourselves in competition with all of them from a business perspective. So that's, you know, very important for all of you to know. Interesting, the conversation that I had with these clients was not a pretty conversation, but it was a conversation that needed to be had. You know, some of the clients that I talked to last week, out of the five clients, you know, some of them are rethinking whether they want to retire in 2022 or they want to wait a little longer. Because at the end of the day, you know, once you start to go into the retirement path, and now you're going to be dependent on your retirement accounts, and you're going to be dependent on your Social Security benefits and or any other type of investments that you may have, then obviously you need to pay a lot more attention to how you spend your dollars every single day, because otherwise you may very well run out of money before you run out of life. And I can tell you this because I have had clients at that level as well. You know, if getting old is bad, getting old and having no money is even worse. So you got to be very careful with that, because the minute that you retire, whatever dollars you have saved, those are the dollars that are hopefully going to take you to the promised land from a business perspective. So finally, I think we need to be able to embrace chaos. How do we do that? Well, we have to look at our own personal economy, and for each and every one of you, everything is different. For these five clients that I reviewed last week that are now fast approaching retirement in 2022, they all look totally different. You know, some of them have larger qualified plan accounts, like 401ks, IRAs. Others have larger Roth accounts and municipal bonds, which pay no federal income taxes and so forth moving forward into the future. Some of them get a larger Social Security benefit than others. Some are older than the others. Some are still living with mortgages. Others have, you know, paid off their mortgages, so they don't have to pay mortgages on their homes and so forth. Two of the five clients that I reviewed do not live in South Florida, which, you know, has become very, very expensive. Two of them, actually, one lives in South Carolina and the other one lives in North Carolina, and I visited one of them back in April when I did a road trip with my wife through the Carolinas, and we had a good time. So depending where you live, depending how far do you live from the city, depending on how much money you need in order to maintain your standard of living, all of those things are going to make an impact whether you're going to have a successful retirement plan or not. But at the end of the day, you better have a plan, because, you know, most people fail not because their plan failed, but because they just failed to plan. So those are things that are very, very interesting. I know that I'm bringing some issues to all of you that you should all be concerned with. You know, another thing that I would suggest, and I'm going to plug in this, you know, as a plug-in for my book, but I wrote a book which went for sale in Amazon in January of this year, which is called Retirement Paradigms, Managing Retirement Risks in the 21st Century. So I do encourage each and every one of you to go to Amazon. You can download it or you can buy the actual book. It's very, very good reading. And a lot of the topics that we talk about today, you know, are there for you to, and I go deeper into the different topics so you can get a better understanding of, you know, how to manage risk in the 21st century, because it's not going to get any easier moving forward from a business standpoint. You know, as I always say, even a broken clock is right twice a day. So for that reason, please feel free to call me if you have any questions at all. You can reach out to me at area code 786-766-1042, 786-766-1042, or you can send me an email at Bert, B-E-R-T, at BertSalazar.com, BertSalazar.com. And always, always remember that my goal for you and for your family and for those of you that have a business, even for your business, is to, you know, kind of help you change the way that you look at things. Because when you change the way that you look at things, the things that you see change. So once again, thank you so much for giving me a few minutes of your time, and I'll talk to you next week. Take care. Bye-bye.